My dear fellow, there's nothing improbable at all about my explanation. In fact, it's perfectly ordinary. Old Mr. Thomas Cardew, who adopted me when I was a little boy, made me in his will guardian to his granddaughter, Miss Cecily Cardew. Cecily, who addresses me as her uncle, from motives of respect that you could not possibly appreciate, lives at my place in the country under the charge of her admirable governess, Miss Prism.
Where is that place in the country, by the way?
That is nothing to you, dear boy. You're not going to be invited. I may tell you quite candidly that the place is not in Shropshire.
Well, I suspected that, my dear fellow. I have buzzworried all over Shropshire on two separate occasions. Now go on. Why are you Ernest in town and Jack in the country?
My dear Algy, I don't know whether you'll be able to understand my real motives. You're hardly serious enough. When one is placed in the position of guardian, one has to adopt a very high moral tone on all subjects. It's one's duty to do so. And as a high moral tone can hardly be said to conduce very much either to one's health or one's happiness, in order to get up to town, I've always pretended to have a younger brother by the name of Ernest, who lives in the Albany and gets into the most dreadful scrapes. And that, my dear Algy, is the whole truth, pure and simple.
The truth is rarely pure. It's never simple. Modern life would be very tedious if it were either, and modern literature, complete impossibility.
And that wouldn't be at all a bad thing.
Literary criticism is not your forte, my dear fellow. Don't try it. You should leave that to people who have not been at university. They do so well in the daily papers. No, what you really are is a Bunburyist. I was quite right in saying you were a Bunburyist. In fact, you're one of the most advanced Bunburyists I know.
Now, what on earth do you mean?
You have invented a very useful younger brother called Ernest, and with that you may be able to come up to town whenever you like. I have invented an invaluable permanent invalid called Bunbury in order that I can go down into the country whenever I choose. And Bunbury is perfectly invaluable. If it wasn't for Bunbury's extraordinary bad health, for instance, I wouldn't be able to dine with you at Willis's tonight, for I have really been engaged to Aunt Augusta for more than a week.
I haven't asked you to dine with me anywhere tonight.
I know. You are absurdly careless about sending out invitations. It's really very foolish of you. Nothing annoys people more than not receiving invitations.
I think you would much better dine with your Aunt Augusta.
I haven't the smallest intention of doing anything of the kind. To begin with, I dine there on Monday, and once a week is quite enough to dine with one's own relations. In the second place, whenever I do dine there, I'm always treated as a member of the family and sent down with either no woman at all or two. In the third place, I know perfectly well who she will place me next to tonight. She will place me next to Mary Farquhar, who always flirts with her own husband across the dinner table. That's not very pleasant. Indeed, it's not even decent. And that sort of thing is enormously on the increase. The amount of women in London who flirt with their own husbands, it's perfectly scandalous. It looks so bad. It's simply washing one's clean linen in public. Besides, now that I know you to be a confirmed Bunburyist, I naturally want to talk to you about Bunburying. I want to tell you all the rules.
I'm not a Bunburyist at all. If Gwendolyn accepts me, I'm going to kill my brother. Indeed, I think I'll kill him in any case. Cecily's a bit too much interested in him. It's rather a bore. So I'm going to get rid of Ernest, and I strongly advise you to do the same with with your invalid friend who has the absurd name.
Nothing will induce me to part with Bunbury, and if you ever get married, which seems to me extremely problematic, then you'll be very happy to know Bunbury. A man who marries without knowing Bunbury has a very tedious time of it.
That is nonsense. If I marry a charming girl like Gwendolyn, and she's the only girl I ever saw in my life that I would marry, certainly won't want to know Bunbury.
Then your wife will. You don't seem to realize that in marriage, three is company and two is none.
And that, my dear young friend, is the theory that the corrupt French drama has been propounding for the last 50 years.
Yes, and that the happy English home has proved in half the time.
Oh, for heaven's sake, don't try to be cynical. It's perfectly easy to be cynical.
My dear fellow, it isn't easy to be anything nowadays. There's so much beastly competition about. That would be Aunt Augusta. Only relatives or creditors ever ring in that Wagnerian manner. Now, if I can get her out of the way for 10 minutes, that you have an opportunity of proposing to Gwendolyn, may I dine with you tonight at Phyllis's?
I suppose so. If you want to.
Yes, but you must be serious about it. I hate people who are not serious about their meals. It's so shallow of them.